Welcome to the Expat Edge with Marcus and Matt, where we answer your questions about becoming an expat to help you thrive abroad. Hey everyone, welcome to the Expat Edge. In this video, we're talking about annoying things you've noticed about America after having lived abroad. I'm in Germany, Matt's in Texas. Matt, you can probably think of a few more things than I can, being there, you know, being in the US. What are some kind of top things that you are annoyed about after kind of moving back to the US from being abroad? Sure.
So the number one thing that's horrible in the United States after living abroad is healthcare. Now I should make one kind of comment first that the quality of healthcare in the United States is generally very good. The process by which you get it and the insurance system is where all of the problems come in. So, I mean, just navigating the system, trying to figure it out, it's just ridiculous. And the cost is astronomical. I mean, I have to pay $1,500 a month for health insurance. And when I go to the doctor, you still have to pay more. So it's incredibly expensive. Right. But I mean, the quality of care is good. Whereas in Russia, for example, where I used to live, you could go to the doctor anytime for $30 or $40. You could even see specialists for that amount of money with, you know, you didn't have to wait. You just pay and go see them. Then again, I wouldn't want to have some rare disease in Russia or any other developing country. Because the quality of healthcare is not as good, but the system in which it works, at least the private healthcare systems, is usually quite good, because it's for profit. So for me, that was number one for sure.
Yeah, I have had limited experience with the healthcare system in the US as an adult and my family and things, because we've spent most of our time outside the US. But I can say, you know, with having a child, we had our first child in the US and our second and third in Germany. And, you know, that's vastly different, because when I tell Russians or Germans about the healthcare system in the US, where, you know, you have this copay and then you have, you know, expensive medications, you still pay for those. And then, by the way, you know, if you have good insurance, you pay, I don't know, 20% and the policy covers the rest, or, you know, you have your, and then I explain what a deductible is, and depending on that, you pay, I don't know, $5,000 out of the year. So it's very complicated, and people, especially in Germany, where the healthcare system is very good, they just look at me like, why do you need to, you know, go through all that? So that kind of makes me think, you know, maybe there's a better way. So. Right. That is definitely something that I've noticed as well.
Right. The second thing that really annoyed me when we first came back. Now, again, this probably depends on where you lived abroad. But generally, most of the world is pretty good with public transportation, right? The United States is notoriously right. Horrible for public transportation. So when we first moved back, we lived in Washington, D.C., which by U.S. standards has a very good public, I didn't say very good, public transportation system. The metro system's, you know, pretty vast. You can go just about anywhere on the train. But still, there are lots of problems. There are delays. There are closures. When I first started my job, when I came back to the U.S., I remember I said, the Friday before I start on Monday, I'm going to do like a dry run in the metro just to see, you know, like where I need to walk. So I understand, because it's not very clear, right? You come out of the station and right. You got to figure out where you're going. I just didn't want to have any stress Monday morning. So I took the train. We were living. I didn't even have to make any changes. It was just a straight shot down the metro line. I took the train. I was like, oh, that's easy. And then I went back home. And then Monday morning, I get up, I go to the metro station, I get on the train, and it goes two stops and it says, please exit the train. There's construction for the next 6 weeks and this line is no longer working. And I was thinking, what in the heck is this? So I had to do a change, and now I'm at this, you know, station I'd never seen before, and I'm, you know, running late from work now, my first day, and just ridiculous. I mean, you would never encounter that in Russia, at least where we lived, right? I mean, the metro is super right. efficient. The trains come every 30 seconds at rush hour. That's another thing. The trains come, if you're lucky, every 5 minutes at rush hour in the United States. So like, you miss a train, the next one comes 7 minutes later. And, you know, that's doesn't seem like much. But if you're trying to get somewhere on time, then that's quite a bit of time, especially if you then have to take a transfer somewhere, then I could add another 7 minutes because you just missed the next train. So it's ridiculous how bad public transportation is here. And then in addition to that, outside of the metro, you really can't go anywhere. So in most countries, you've got like a metro and then a bus system. You have buses here in the US, but they're not very good. They don't go everywhere. So you've got to get off the metro, right, and you've got to walk along. It's horrible. And many places, even in cities with public transportation, you can't even get somewhere with public transportation. You need a car. So, uh-huh. I mean, I'm used to it now.
You drive to the end station.
Yeah.
In Germany, even in these small towns, you know, you have a bus station, maybe, or a buses running, maybe not so often, but you can get by. I would say it'd be tough without a car in some of these small towns, but in the US it's impossible. They're just, some buses don't even run. So you always have to, I remember growing up, you know, in rural Oregon, outside of Portland, if you wanted to go somewhere, you'd have to catch a ride, you know, ask someone to drive you 20 minutes to the end station.
Yeah.
Well, as a kid, because you can't drive, of course, but the culture just in the US. I remember when I was living in Utah, there was this great plan for, you know, this expansion of the public transportation system. You know, lots of money was poured into it, but they just want to drive, or it's cheap to drive, you know, for whatever reason, they don't have right. enough people using it.
Right.
Whereas a lot of people in Europe and Russia depend on it because they don't have cars.
Right. I mean, we always had a car, but for example, we lived a 5 minute walk from the last stop on the metro station, but you couldn't walk to a grocery store.
Oh,
right. So like you could live there, you could take the metro to get to work. I mean, I guess you could take the metro a few stops and then you'd be near a grocery store. But again, it's not like, it's just not that easy. Then you've got all these groceries and you're like, you got to wait 20 minutes on the weekend for the train because that's how often it runs. You know, just all of this is just ridiculous compared to,
right.
again, Russia, which is a developing country, you know, at best. I mean, Moscow is maybe pretty developed, but outside of Moscow, I mean, it's a developing country outside of the major cities. It's hardly even developed. You know, it's, you know, very rural, but there's still public transportation.
Right, right.
Another thing I think that's kind of frustrating about coming back to the US, you know, Americans get made fun of a lot for not knowing a lot about geography, not knowing a lot about the world. And you don't really notice that until you leave and come back, right? And when you've right. lived abroad and you come back and things frustrate you, people will ask you, oh, like, aren't you glad to be back? And in the very beginning, I don't know about you, Marcus, you know, I guess you went to another country, so there's just different things to focus on. But when I came back to the US, the first 6 months were incredibly difficult because nobody understood kind of what you were going through. You've got a new job. Right. It's just, it's very, very difficult, actually. Reverse culture shock is actually harder than the culture shock you experienced going to another country. So, I mean, with good friends, you know, they'll start talking about sports and whatnot. And you think, well, I haven't followed sports in 5 years. I have no idea what's going on. Or music, or like all of these kind of local things that you're so far out of touch with, and you probably find less interesting than you did before you left. I mean, I don't know about you, but I followed sports pretty closely before I went to Russia. And when I was in Russia,
right.
I got out of it. And now I have no desire whatsoever to watch sports. I get no benefit whatsoever of watching it.
I mean, so I was just going to ask, do you mean like, it's harder to relate to to your friends around you, your colleagues, because you're kind of away, you are isolated so much? I mean, not isolated, but you know what I mean? You if you want to confide in somebody, they just don't understand what you're trying, the angle you're coming from.
Yes, exactly. So what I've found actually is that most or almost all of my friends are people who have lived abroad, Americans who have lived abroad or foreigners here in the US.
Or I've had that situation too, where I'll be, you know, visiting friends and family in the US, and I relate to a foreigner from another country in the US more than, you know, somebody I meet, just an American that I meet who has no right. experience abroad whatsoever.
Right. Exactly. I mean,
and
I still
have
very...
count if they've been a tourist or something in a, you know, if they, oh, I visited that country, you know, as a tourist, but they still don't really get
right.
it.
Right. Well, for me, I mean, you will always retain your, you know, good relationships from childhood and college because you've got so many shared experiences that you can, you know, reminisce about. But building new relationships with just regular Americans, I found was really difficult after living abroad. But fortunately, in any big city, you've got lots of meetup opportunities. I used to go to this Central Asia happy hour or Russia themed happy hour in Washington, D.C., and met all kinds of people who'd lived there before or were just interested in different cultures. So, I mean, that's the great thing about America is that that exists, but you have to find it. But I think the hardest thing for me coming back was just being unable to relate to a lot of things that people found interesting in the U.S., like sports, that I no longer had any interest in.
Right.
So, I don't know. I mean, there's a lot of other things about America that are frustrating. You have to tip everywhere, even if the service is bad. You know, you get used to everywhere else in the world, you'd leave a tip if you were very pleased with the service. You come back to the U.S. and service generally in the U.S. is pretty bad, to be honest. You go to a hotel, even like a 3 or 4 star hotel in Europe, and, you know, people are really nice. They're going out of their way to help you and, you know, do things. You come to a 3 or 4 star hotel in the U.S., it's just like, what is this? Nobody helps you with anything. There's just no service whatsoever. And you're expected to leave tips at the restaurant, you know, that are 20 or 25%. It's crazy. If you go to a 5-star hotel in Asia or even in Russia, I mean, we stayed at the 5-star hotel in Moscow the last time we were there. It was $100 a night, but it was over the top. When you walk in, they'd be like, hello, Mr. Shannon, how are you doing today? In English or Russian, it didn't matter. Here, you go to a 5-star hotel, it's like $1,000 a night, and they don't even, you know, there's no level of service. I mean, it looks nice, right? But it's very different.
I think we covered that in a different video on Russia where we talked about the service. Like if you pay well for the service, it's much, much better.
But it's not just a Russia thing. I mean, like, I was just in Turkey for work and we stayed at a 5-star hotel for work and it was just like in Russia. I mean, everything was fantastic. The food was great. You go here to a 5-star restaurant and I don't know, the food's not that good. That's just my experience. Yeah. I mean, maybe I just haven't gone and maybe I haven't paid $1,000 for dinner. But we went to a restaurant the other day with some of our friends here. It was way too expensive for, you know, what we got, in my opinion. It was $500 for 4 of us to eat. It was like a, you know, a nice steakhouse here where we live. Yeah. And it was not worth that at all. I mean, in Turkey, you could go to, you know, just a regular restaurant and get service that was better. Let alone if you go to a top quality place, it's going to be way cheaper because of the economy is different, obviously. But the level of service is very different here in the U.S. And it's weird because people say, you know, the U.S. is customer service is fantastic, but not really. I mean, low level service is good.
The standard is higher in general, and people are, you know, mostly superficial and smile, and so it seems friendly, but you know, when you need to get extra service or you're in a difficult situation, then maybe it's different.
Right. Well, I would say the lowest level of service in the U.S. is quite good, right? So even if you go to McDonald's and they screw up your order, there's no one's ever going to give you a hard time. They're going to make it right.
That's a good example. Yeah. Whereas in another place, even in Germany, this service, I wouldn't say is very good because in that same situation, they're just going to be like, well, you misunderstood me or I misunderstood, you know, they're not going to take the blame. I've had that in Russia too, the low level service. So that's an interesting point. Some other annoying things that came to my mind was when I came back from Russia specifically, and even being in Germany and then visiting the US, the pace at which mobile apps and new mobile apps are developed is faster in Russia. So I was like, do you have an app for this? Do you have an app for this? And I couldn't find it. It was just kind of annoying to not be able to, you know, keep that level of
expectations. Well, what's interesting is, even 5 or 6 years ago, you could tap your card literally anywhere in Russia to pay or pay with your phone. To this day, I can't pay at any of the grocery stores with my phone here in Texas where I live. Walmart, Kroger, HEB, you can do it at Whole Foods.
You have to put your card in.
You have to put the chip in. Yes.
Got it.
Also the chips.
Because here in Germany, I pay, you know, by tapping my phone all the time.
Yeah, you can't do it. Can't do it here.
Interesting. So, well, those are some of the annoying things that we, you know, that you will notice if you go abroad, spend some time abroad. You'll notice them right away when you come back to the U.S. and or, you know, travel around to different countries.
If you have any experiences coming back to the U.S. after seeing things that were done better in other countries, let us know in the comments below and we'll see you in another video.
This was the Expat Edge with Matt and Marcus. We hope you enjoyed the video. Visit theexpatedge.com for even more content that will help you thrive abroad. You can submit your ideas for video topics and sign up for free at theexpatedge.com. See you there.